mute myself for a second and holler for my family because I'm going to ask my kids to help light the candles. They're coming. All right, if you have candles wherever you are, you can get them ready too. We're going to light. So my boys, Adam and Daniel, are expert candle lighters by now. And just reminding everyone to mute so that we can have a consistent view and so on. All right, here's Daniel, here's Adam. All right, guys, when you're ready, please light the candles.
We are.
Okay, go ahead. There we go. All right, Daniel. Nice. All right, we scoop in the light.
Let's scoop.
So scoop it in. And you could take a breath here. And just let it go and just... with that exhale, take a few more breaths and just arrive in the day of rest. And this practice, which has sustained us for so many generations of just pausing and being without productivity. Baruch atah Adonai. Eloheinu melech ha'olam asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lehadlikner shel Shabbat. Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom. All right, wait, don't go yet. Let's do a blessing for kids and just okay. So first, all right, kiddush and then kid blessing. Okay, so let's get, if you have wine or juice or other beverages wherever you are, you can lift them up now.
Is that wine?
It is wine. Wait, boys, come.
Stay here.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. All right. Okay. Now, if you have kids in your life, and whether they're your own or they're the children of other people that you love, whether they are in your home or far away, bring them into your heart. And boys, come. So we're going to sing the Or Shalom blessing song here. Children's blessing song, and I invite you to bring into your heart any children that you know who you want to send a blessing to. Here we are on this night of Shabbat, the candles are lit, and do you know what? Now's our chance to bless all our kids, wherever you are, in college or cribs. How shall we bless you? What do we want for you? Only everything. May you be healthy. May you be happy, having all you need and wish for. Every day you brighten our lives, give warmth to our hearts and light to our eyes. We're so glad that you kids are here, safe in our love, nothing to fear. May you be healthy, may you be happy, having all you need. Now and forever with you wherever, may you know how much we love you. Ya la la la, ya la la ya. Ya la la ya, ya la la ya, ya la la la, la 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 ya, ya la la ya, ya la la la, ya la 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 la, ya la 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 la, ya la la ya ya. Shabbat shalom, guys. Thank you. Bye. Thank you for coming for these blessings. All right. Love you. And off they go. So if you have hands, raise them now. You can lift them high up into the air if you like and just shake off anything that you don't want to bring with you into this next 25 hours. So we're going to lift our hands. The blessing for hand washing is actually says, Al netilat yadayim, upon raising of the hands. And so we raise our hands and let go. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kidshanu b'mitzvah tavitzivanu al netilat yadayim. And now touch whatever bread you have, if you have bread near you. And mine is not glorious, so I'm not going to make a big deal of showing it to you. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Amen. Bread. All right, so if you're eating, and I'm going to take a sip of water, and then we'll get going with our dialogue here. So, this is actually Rabbi Deborah Waxman's third visit to Or Shalom, she was reminding me. And we're so blessed that this time you didn't even have to get in a plane. You're just tuning in. She's tuning in all the way from Philadelphia. And just want to say a couple words of introduction, and then we'll get going. So Rabbi Deborah Waxman is now finishing her seventh year as the president of Reconstructing Judaism. And she and I met years and years ago when I was a student at RRC. She was already in the administration at that time, but not yet president. And our focus for tonight is going to be the podcast Hashivenu that Rabbi Deborah Waxman has created and offered to the world. And Hashivenu is a podcast about Jewish teachings on resilience. And she's, going to share with us some insights about that. She's doing this and other parts of her work in part as an effort to raise the Reconstructionist perspective in the public square. There's so much that our movement has to offer as relevant, deeply rooted wisdom for our moment. Reconstructionism has always been about that. So we'll talk to her a little bit about how that informs her work and her thinking. And as we move into this part of things, we are going to be in dialogue, so we suggest that you use speaker view, but you can use whatever view you want. And I have a number of questions that I've prepared. If you have a burning question that you can't that you don't think we're getting to, you can send it in the chat to Lillian and she'll try to send it along to me, but hopefully we'll cover a lot of what interests you. So with that, Deborah, I thought maybe you could just start with a general story, or tell us a little bit about the origin of Hashivenu and how it came into being.
I'm so happy to. Thanks. It's so lovely to be with all of you and to see your faces. I miss being in the same room with people and the energy and the unplanned conversations. And I'm just, it's also such a blessing to be able to, for me, it's 10 o'clock on Friday night to kind of, to zoom in and to be with all of you and to see you in your homes and for you to get a glimpse of mine. So Hashivenu is, I have to say, I feel very, very honored and very, very lucky to do the work that I do. And I feel really energized by when I'm able to travel or if I'm zooming in and I like to teach. I mean, there's so many things about the work that I get to do that really fill me up and allow me to be feeling like I am being of service. And this podcast, Hashivenu, is quite possibly my favorite thing to do, because I am a big fan of podcasts. I listen to them a little bit less now in COVID times, because I'm realizing that I do a lot of them in transit. And so I'm not in transit so much anymore. But one reason I like to do it is because there's an intimacy, you know, like you're in a lot of, many people listen to podcasts through earphones. And so you're really, I'm keenly aware of how close I am able to come to people. And I really love relationships and I really love being with people. So I feel grateful for that. The other thing is that I feel that podcasts are, I come into it with a real learner's stance. The format of Hashivenu is a dialogue. I am interviewing people. The podcast is Lily and I put a link in the chat if you want to post it for people who haven't listened. We've recorded 36 posted 36 episodes over the last 3 years. They're between 25 and 40 minutes long, and so it's a very wonderful exchange. When I say to guests, like, let's try to create the experience so people feel like they're listening in to a really wonderful conversation. And there, I am not usually the expert. I'm not usually the person that people are looking to for the answers. I am there as a stand-in for all the listeners. I mean, I have a lot of, I shape the podcast working with others who counsel me. But then I bring in people with more expertise and with more wisdom, and I get to learn. And that is such a blessing for me to be in the stance of a learner and where I get to just be there from a place of curiosity. Mm-hmm. I was pretty clear that I wanted to do a podcast about 4 years ago. I started to think about what I would do. And one of the ideas I had was to maybe interview rabbis about what they care about and, what there's a saying we say about rabbis that every rabbi has one sermon that they just give again and again, and to ask people, well, what's your one sermon, and I thought, but I'll tell you that the origins of this podcast came, that it crystallized that I wanted to do it around resilience right after the 2016 election. I was personally really devastated and really flattened and really felt like I needed to figure out how to move forward. And I really noticed a very profound shift in myself where, the Reconstructionist movement, we've been on a lot of cutting edges. We've been at the forefront. And, like you referenced, our tagline is deeply rooted, boldly relevant. And I felt like in my work, I was leaning more heavily into the relevant piece. And there were times when I felt like I was helping to drag the Jewish community into the future. And after the election, it just hit me overwhelmingly that our ancestors had lived through incredible tumult, an incredible crisis, an incredible trauma, and had found ways throughout Jewish history to live full and gorgeous and connected and joy-filled lives, even in the midst of a burning world. And that I noticed in myself very, very quickly this pivot away from, I want to look boldly toward the future to, what is it that I can draw from the path that will enable me to keep moving forward with courage into the future? And that recognition and that understanding of the resilience that I think is really embedded into Jewish wisdom and Jewish living, that's how it crystallized into the podcast. And what I'll say is that the more I explored that lens of resilience, the richer and more meaningful I found that exploration. I found that connection.
So great. I would love to just go with that for a minute and ask you about if you have any favorite stories of resilience that have come to you in your interviews or in your life.
Sure. I'll draw from both. The storytelling, I think, is some of the most powerful pieces. And indeed, when I started the podcast, I did a fair amount of research on resilience. And I just want to, before I go to stories, I just want to, and I've talked a little bit, I think the first time I came to Or Shalom, I was just really kind of starting on this work. And one of the things that I'm doing is I'm drawing on the field of resilience from psychology and using it to, and setting it alongside Judaism and examining Judaism from that perspective. And so when I began, I was really looking at categories of and expressions of resilience and bringing them to a Jewish exploration. So for example, I started, the very first episode was about Shabbat, because it is such a place for rest and for renewing. And that emerged so powerfully out of the resilience research. But another early thing that I brought on, the first year I was tying it to that year cycle, the holidays. And one factor that cultivates resilience is humor. And so I was looking for ways to talk about humor from a Jewish perspective, and we tied it to Sukkot, which is known as Zman Simchatenu. And it was a great, great, great conversation, including where we were telling jokes. And I'm a terrible joke teller. I always forget the punchline and I give it away. And so there was some humor to it as well. But I found in the end that actually the storytelling is far more powerful than that kind of, and allowing it to really emerge more organically is, and that's what people remember more than anything. So I want to say to all of you who are on this call, like, if you want to, a request to turn off the fan. I can do that. I'm going to disappear, just because I have to go to the wall.
All right. So Deborah is. We hear the request to turn off the fan. She's turning off the fan. Deborah, you should know we're all in a Bay Area heat wave. So we're all with you. If you get, if that makes you hot, we're all going to be in it together.
That's great. We're surprisingly cool for we just came out of a heat wave, and it's actually so. But I know that it can be irritating, distracting. So I was going to say is that if for those of you who are on the Zoom, if you want to hear one of the most powerful stories of all the interviews that I've done, I would really urge you to listen to the interview that I did with Susan Levine, who's on the call. It was a live broadcast. We did it from convention. We recorded it live with an audience, and I know Katie, you were there. And so Susan tells the extraordinary story of, and speaks very forthrightly about her own attempt to take her life and a pivot away from that and choosing life again and again. And it's one of the most downloaded episodes that we've done. The episodes are pretty evergreen. And so the longer they're up, the more people listen to them. And that's one of them. And it's just an incredibly powerful and moving example of resilience. And you know what I'll say is that, you know, resilience, it's a noun, but it's a process. It's not once and done, and it's something that we return to again and again. And what I like about resilience is it's a positive framing, but it's the tail end of an arc that presumes trauma or hurt or pain. And part of what I think is so compelling about that interview with Susan is that she talks about how she makes the choice again and again and again to choose life. That's such, you know, we all have the, I think many of us have had the experience of this person who has something terrible happen to them and it seems like they recover quickly and instantly. And that is extraordinary and to be celebrated. And I think much more often there is this this need to pick it up again and again and to reinforce it again and again. And so to move away from Susan's story to something, I was just thinking a lot about it. Katie and I have a colleague who suffered a terrible tragedy. She has three sons, had three sons, and her oldest child at age 19, when he was a sophomore at Princeton, was diagnosed with a rare childhood cancer. And he battled the cancer bravely, and she supported him, and, you know, was as hands-on as she needed to be, and as hands-off as she needed to be, and still somehow had a life separate from his illness. And it went on for about 4 years, and he died so tragically. And so that was one of the saddest funerals I've ever been to. And I can picture her at his coffin. And it was one of those things where you wonder, how will she ever get up from this? And this was, I guess, about 4 years ago that Arya died. And I saw her about 2 weeks ago. We've been trying to connect, and she was hard to reach. And we met up at a birthday parade for another rabbi friend. And with our masks, she said, "Well, let's meet next week. I'm sorry I've been so unavailable. I just finished my master's in family counseling." She was glowing. And I knew she had done this, and she said, "You know, this has given me new life." And I said to her, "You are such an inspiration that you have found a path forward of meaning and connection and relationship." And she said that what comes next, because she's got to do many hours of certification and supervision and everything, is about marrying together her rabbinic training with her this new therapeutic training. And so to see that, you know, it was not a straightforward path, it was not easy, but for her to and part of what the resilience research tells us is, if we find ways to live lives of service and of meaning and of connection, that's what helps to cultivate resilience. And that's, you know, I think that's where it maps on so precisely to Judaism, is that Judaism invites us to live lives of service and of meaning and of interdependence.
What a story. I loved what you said about how resilience is this dynamic, and how it presumes the down, it presumes the trauma and the breaking and the wounding, and it's not about somehow happiness or perfection. It's about some dynamic way of moving from that low place to a better place. And it's not instantaneous, it's not necessarily linear, it's not easy, but it is something that our people have learned about and practiced and thought about for so long. And you mentioned at least one of the ways, I heard you say that one of the things that marries the Jewish way of being resilient and the sort of research social science wise that says, you know, being of service, creating meaning, is one of the ways that we can be resilient. I think about I think it was last year, I was teaching a class about teshuva, about this process of repentance or returning to our higher selves or our core sacred self at this time of year. And in the class, there was a woman who's a member of our community who I know doesn't mind me talking about this, who talked about in that class how she had been through a terrible journey of being an addict and an alcoholic, and how part of her resilience in being now many years in recovery is being of service, that she couldn't change all the dark experience of the past, but she can make use of it for the sake of others, that she can take that hard experience, that suffering that she experienced and that she caused, and she can redeem even that by using it to help others get move through their own dark places. And so you've been exploring resilience now for 3 years on your podcast. You've had lots of people, many wise souls, and I would love to hear you talk more about you know, what other key elements or practices that you've discovered or learned about in your searching here about resilience? Like, what works?
Well, I'm going to share with you what listeners seem to be really liking, the episodes that have been most resonant and most popular, and I'll share with you a couple of like the ones that have been most moving to me, and they're often the same. And I'll tell you a little bit about making the podcast. Like, we, you know, there are two different kinds of podcasts. And like, one is like the This American Life kind, where it's very heavily edited and it's multiple voices and it's a very complex narrative. And we don't do that because, we've done that for some podcasts, but that takes a lot, like, you know, it's like 4, 5 or 6 hours for every 10 minutes of the podcast. And we just don't have that kind of resources. So mine is, as I said, it's like mostly, you know, it's a variation of what we're doing right now. We usually ask the guests to set aside about 90 minutes and we spend a chunk of time talking. And often I'll email beforehand, and then sometimes we hit live, you know, hit the recording. And the great thing about, one of the things that I'm always most anxious about is when I'm on live television, because I can't just say, wait, stop, can we do that again? You know, and I say to guests, like, if you are saying something and you don't think it's coming out right, just let us know and we'll start on it. And Sam Wax is a wonderful editor and producer, and he makes everybody look really, really good. So sometimes when we go to the recording, it's exactly some version of what we've talked about. And sometimes it goes completely unexpectedly. And some of those are, and everything that we did before was really just like baseline preparation for some kind of big jump into much deeper. So one of my absolute favorite episodes where that happened, and it is, I think, the number 2 download, was with Rabbi Miriam Klotz, who teaches with the Institute for Jewish Spirituality. And we were talking, the title of the podcast is Hineni, Being Present. And we were talking about how are we present? How do we bring ourselves, our bodies and our brains and our hearts together into one space? And I thought we were talking mostly in religious settings, but we were also talking about like moving through the world. And so Mira and I, we said, oh, we'll talk about this and we'll talk about that. But while we were in the podcast, she said, well, you know, I often do it through guided meditation. And we kind of, you know, we did it in person, and we said, well, why don't we do it? So instead of talking about it, she actually led me on a guided meditation right then and there. And it was the bulk of the podcast, and it was so beautiful. And I remember that day that we back in the day when we were places other than our houses, it's a tiny little cocoon that we have a little podcast studio we built. And it's a tiny, lovely cocoon. And I remember entering it very, very tired and leaving it like a completely different person. I mean, she had gotten me so very present. And so that that kind of practice of, and I still use the meditation, and sometimes I use what she's taught. I don't know it well enough to reteach it, but sometimes I'll just chant to myself, Hineni, Hineni. Here I am. And it's just enough of a prompt to bring myself much more. If I am feeling scattered and with my energy all over, that kind of intentionality is one thing that works. A kind of a mindful awareness that we are, that what we are experiencing right now is not the whole reality, and that we can bring a different sensibility. So certainly all of the practices of mindfulness, whether they are Jewishly informed or from other traditions, are really helpful for resilience. Another episode that's very, I mean, the Shabbat episode has double any other download. And I do think that Shabbat really is such a, you know, the stopping, the pausing, the intentionally setting aside. I used to try to be offline as much as possible. I'm not always, when I'm not zooming into congregations, I don't always zoom into my own minyan because I need a break. But I think that kind of intentional practice of setting aside is critical for resilience. Another episode, I would say, that is very, very popular and very moving was another one with Rabbi Jonathan Kligler, who's the rabbi of the Woodstock Jewish Congregation in Woodstock, New York. And he talked about embodied prayer. He comes from a dance background, and he led us through how he leads his congregation in the morning blessings. Blessed are you, Adonai, who opens the eyes of the blind. And he asks congregants to pause. You know, it take a long time. They take 10 minutes to go through their morning blessings, but because to really to pause and to pay attention to their eyes and then to open their eyes. And so again, that kind of integration and access. And we spend a lot of time talking about somatics and about the body. And I think that that's actually a really important corrective to the rationalistic strain of Judaism. And I think a theme throughout the podcast and that is, you know, consistent with the resilience research is about trying to integrate head and heart and body and looking for practices that will help us. I think that there's an episode, I think we might re-release it. There's an episode, I often will just, when something excites me or interests me, I'll reach out to someone, or sometimes people will reach out to me, and then I interview them, and then we schedule it, we release it at some other point in time. So last year in my little minion, Dor Shederach, which is a Reconstructionist community, I was leading Kol Nidre, and a member of the community was giving the Dvar Torah, and he's a psychoanalyst, and he talked about, he had started as a climate researcher, he'd started as a scientist, and he was, and it, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, he was so devastated by the impending approach of climate, of global warming, that he felt like he had to leave because he was going to be consumed by depression. And he switched over to trauma-informed psychology. And he gave this absolutely beautiful Dvar Torah on what trauma therapy has taught him about cultivating resilience. And we recorded it, I recorded it probably in, I think, December. And because it grew out of a Yom Kippur talk, we were talking a lot about Unatana Tokef and how the high holidays and especially Yom Kippur, like it aims to like flail us. It aims us to strip us of our skin and make us entirely naked and entirely vulnerable to confront hard realities in the hopes that we are transformed and that we get up and really enact what is most important, our values, our relationships, the impact that we can make in the world. And so when we finished the recording, we had said, you know, I said to him, I think we're probably going to release this. We're going to sit on this for 9 months. I've never sat on anything that long, but I think we'll sit on it and we'll release it as a holiday episode. And then about 6 weeks later, the pandemic started. And the existential nature of this crisis that we're in, certainly medically, certainly like in terms of our health, and then secondarily, in terms of the economy, and you know, now as it unfolds also in terms of our democracy, and it just seemed that his wisdom, his Torah was such that we released it like in late March as being appropriate to the moment. So that was one that, and part of his teaching is about, you know, feeling our smallness and acting with agency, you know, not letting it not getting buried under it, but understanding it as humility, and then activating the agency that we do have to make the impact that we can make. And that felt, that feels like incredible. That I think too is deeply, deeply Jewish, deeply aligned with resilience research, and really apt for this moment. Even as high holidays are approaching, this extended Unatana Tokef moment that we've been living in for 5 months now.
Mm. Yeah, so we are so much in an Unatana Tokef moment. That prayer, just for those who may not know that word, that, you know, Unatana Tokef is that prayer at the heart of High Holy Day services of who will live and who will die and who by fire and who by water, and really helping us to face our mortality in this theatrical way, this poetic way. And actually, it's a good bridge for me to ask you, Deborah, how did you pick the name Hashivenu? Because, there's many words you might have picked to be the title of a podcast on resilience. And I'm curious to hear about that. And I also know that there's a connection to the theme song and how that came into being. So I'd love to hear the bridge between Hashivenu and resilience and maybe High Holy Days. Yeah. And also the origin of the song.
I'm so happy to tell the story. And it feels like as it's 3 years in, like it's kind of a little bit faded. I mean, if you listen, like there's that, the Hashivenu, it's the same root as tshuva. Like the root of it is turning. And I chose it for a couple of reasons. It's a line that a lot of Jews know from, if they go to synagogue, even occasionally, from when we're putting the Torah away. It's the very last line from when we're putting the Torah away. Hashivenu Adonai Elecha v'nashuva. Turn us, Adonai, toward you, and we will turn. Chadesh Yamenu Kekedem. Renew us as in days of old. And, you know, and like, so people often know it, Hashivenu, Adonai Elecha. So you know it from like dramatic music, and you know it from walking around the Torah. And it's even though that melody that I was just singing is in the minor key, and pretty much every other melody I know for that line is in the minor key, it's a pretty happy moment because, you know, it's a happy moment, maybe because the services are almost over, but also because like it's an informal, like the Torah's just been out and it's been walked around. It's like been brought out into the community. It's a very democratic moment in its own way, and it's a very community focused moment. But its origins are actually much more ancient, and its origins are, it's the penultimate line. It's the second to last line in the Book of Lamentations. And so it is actually, its origins are not at a happy moment, but at a moment of utter devastation after the destruction of the first temple. I mean, Lamentation seems to have been written about 100 years later, so it's a little bit refracted and a little bit reflected. But nonetheless, the Book of Lamentations, which we just read on Tisha B'Av a couple of weeks ago, a couple of weeks ago, is a moment of utter decimation and devastation, and without a clear understanding of what's going to come next. And so part of what I love about it is that this line in and of itself, and how most of us know it, certainly I, before rabbinical school, only knew it in the synagogue setting, we know it because of a resilience practice of taking pieces of our tradition in a patchwork quilt way and reweaving them into new meaning, not effacing or erasing the previous. It's still there. We still chant it on Tisha B'Av as part of Lamentations, but also raising it up into this new constructive part of the response to the destruction of the temple. So I love the verse itself as an enactment of resilience. And I love it because it invites us to see with both eyes it invites us to see with the trauma and the pain that the original setting tries to capture, and to see the creativity and the even the joy that medieval liturgists used as they put together the service for returning the Torah to the ark. So that's, for me, I mean, it's a long explanation. It's on the website. I use it occasionally when I'm writing op-eds, but to me, it's like so much in Judaism, it works as a short little thing, but that you can just unpack it and unpack it some more, especially because of the tshuva. Turn us, Adonai, and we will turn. And indeed, that line is interspersed throughout the High Holiday Machzor, throughout the High Holiday Prayer Book, because it is such an essential line. So I chose it for the name of the podcast, Hashivenu, and I wanted some music, and I wanted to honor the first eye, the devastation eye, but I wanted to really lean into the creative, reconstructing version of it. And so I decided I was going to commission a song, and I tapped a young woman named Hannah Rothman. She grew up in Darche Noam, the Reconstruction Synagogue in Toronto. She now lives in Philadelphia. She's a very talented musician. And I asked her for a couple of things. I asked her for major key, because in the broadest, crudest way, minor key tends towards sadness and major key tends toward happiness. And I wanted major key. I wanted some English so that it was more accessible, like some translation. It's a more interpretation than a translation. And ideally, I wanted it to be something that I could teach other people. Like so that if I came in person, we could, you know, sometimes when I'm visiting communities, they'll ask to learn new music. I feel really happy about it all, except it's a little too hard to teach. She ended up with a 3-part melody, and I liked it enough that I didn't want her to go back to the drawing board. It's a little hard to teach, and it's a pretty big range of notes. So it, for me, it's a little bit beyond my range. The high notes are a little too high for me. So it's mostly, I think, that the theme song, although there are some communities, I know, like our congregation in Long Island, the Reconstruction Synagogue of the North Shore, they have a very robust music program. And when I went to speak there a couple of years ago, like they greeted me with the whole choir and with several, you know, musicians on instruments were singing. It was really thrilling.
That sounds amazing. Well, I would love to share it with us now. I'm going to ask Lillian to put it through the sound system. And I warn everybody, you may want to just like turn your volume down or be ready to take your earbuds out, because we couldn't get it to be not a little too loud. So we're going to listen. And if you have any burning questions in the meantime, you can put them in the chat. I have about 2 more that I want to ask. And let's take a listen.
Hashivenu Adonai, Hashivenu Adonai, Elecha v'nasuvah. Hashivenu Adonai.
great to have a taste of that. And what a beautiful, fun to sing, and such a reconstruction of Hashivenu, and so fitting. So thank you for bringing that into being along with Hannah Rothman. So great. So I have a couple more questions. I sent you one privately if you want to deal with that one too. So here are my two questions, and you can take them in whatever order you like. So one is, I'm wondering about if there are any ways in which Reconstructionism particularly frames your understanding of resilience. You've touched on it here and there. So that's one, is sort of resilience and Reconstructionism. And the other is about where you have seen resilience in the context of the pandemic or the recent racial justice awakening that's happening. And, you know, I'm curious if anything has surprised you or affirmed some of the things you've learned. So Reconstructionism and resilience, and resilience in this moment.
Yeah. I guess I want to do a little bit of a commercial as I start to answer this. One of the things that we're doing out of Philadelphia for the collection of individuals who work on behalf of the Reconstructionist movement at Reconstructing Judaism is we're pushing out some high holiday resources, including we're going to put out six videos like that we made the Machzor available to support, and we're collecting original music, and we've commissioned six videos, and mine is on cultivating resilience, using the holidays to cultivate resilience, and it kind of is a framing for the entire season. And then there are two that are framing for the entire season. Who I know at Colena a couple of weeks ago, there are a couple that I'm at, and a couple for Yom Kippur. Some of what I'm going to say, if you are anyone is inclined to listen to my teaching, you'll hear me repeat some of this. It draws from some of the thinking that I've done around that high holiday talk. There is, I think, at the heart of a Reconstructionist approach, a commitment to diversity. That there is in Reconstructionism a real resistance to any kind of essentialism. Anyone who says Judaism is X, because that is totalizing and exclusive, whether it's an expansive X or a narrow X. And part of the insight of Reconstructionism is the idea that the Jewish civilization is created by the Jewish people, and we ourselves are very, very diverse in our interests, in our aspiration throughout history, and that the civilization itself has evolved, and even as and we the people have evolved. So Kaplan was really looking for dynamism, really looking to raise up the dynamism that exists within Judaism. And that is one of the reasons why Judaism has survived across millennia. And so he had particular strategies. That was, I think, the core insight that he was trying to use, both to understand it historically and to empower people in his day and in our day to take up that dynamism and to build the Jewish civilization, to build the Jewish community that we want to live in. And so he had particular language that he used to try to communicate that. One was civilization, which 100 years ago, that was very, very meaningful. People talked about the American civilization, and to put up Judaism on a par with the American civilization was very, very powerful. And with other Reconstructionists, they brought to speech the term peoplehood to talk about our connection across time and space. I would suggest, and he actually got Reconstructionism from John Dewey, from the educational philosopher John Dewey. I don't know if any of you have read, we listened to it on an audiobook, the memoir Educated by Tara West something. It's about a really extraordinary memoir about a woman who was raised in a fundamentalist Mormon community, homeschooled, who goes on and gets a doctorate from Oxford. She begins her memoir with an epigraph from John Dewey. And he says, it's from his one of his major speeches in 1897 on pedagogy. And he says, I believe finally that education, and Kaplan was an educator, must be conceived as a continuing reconstruction of experience, and that the process and the goal of education are one and the same thing. And that's where Kaplan got the name Reconstructionism from, because he was so interested in A, education, and the idea that the process and the goal are one and the same. So he had the term Reconstruction, he had the term civilization, he had the term peoplehood, all of it to get toward agency and ongoing development. At our moment, in our day, I think resilience is gets to exactly the same kind of thing, and perhaps even resonates more deeply with contemporary and uncontemporary ears than Kaplan's language does. And I think part of it is because the way that resilience, as I said earlier this evening, it's a noun, but it's a noun that presumes process and unfolding and returning and engagement, and it's not about passivity. It's about you can't purchase resilience. You can't have resilience wash over you. You have to cultivate it. You have to step into it. You have to create an ecosystem and then inhabit it, or enter into an ecosystem and inhabit it and to make it happen. So I really think that using the lens of resilience has both, it's pushed me towards certain practices that Judaism hasn't necessarily. I've tended to do it in Jewish terms. It's like, so for example, I've had a bedtime practice. I've said the bedtime Shema for almost 25 years because I'm a terrible sleeper and I struggle with insomnia, and ritualizing your sleep hygiene helps. And so 25 years ago, before I ever thought about resilience, I said, well, if I'm going to try to ritualize it, I'm going to use Jewish ritual. But it's pushed me much harder on my gratitude practice and to recite Moda Ani every single day. It's pushed me much harder in when I'm doing breath work, in turning to I do a lot of yoga, but to making certain that I have Jewish phrases and Jewish prompts that help me to regulate my breathing. So I think it's both deep in my own Jewish understanding, and I really kind of see it as part and parcel with a Reconstructionist approach. And also, it's an invitation in for people who would necessarily do some practices. They're too intimidated or put off by, or they've been too hurt by Judaism, either the religion itself or by representatives of the religion. But the secular authority, that is reassuring to them. And so it's also been a way to bring in folks who are otherwise distant. I would say that's especially, I do a lot of work in the Jewish social justice sector. Reconstructing Judaism is very active in the Jewish Social Justice Roundtable. And a lot of the activists who are involved in the roundtable are there because they want to do Jewish work, but they are not, they're cultural Jews who don't know anything about Judaism. And So they're doing this work because they're drawn from a Jewish perspective, but they don't have the vocabulary or the experience to articulate it. And I found that approaching it with the resilience lens, they're not fighting with a God they don't believe in. And there's no, they're not fighting with an image of a rabbi as judge. And so it just opens up the door in really new and interesting ways for them.
So, you know, that reminds me, we got a question about whether Reconstructing Judaism is a part of the Poor People's Campaign or is a partner of that. And so you can speak to that. And also, again, you know, in our moment of this racial justice awakening and the pandemic and all that it's revealing, I would love to hear, you know, what you see, where you see resilience in our moment. We also have a request for that Dewey quote, which I know you can't do at the same time as you're talking. So
I just found it. And thank you for reminding me of the second thing. So Lillian, I just put it in the chat to you. So if you could share it with everybody. So Poor People's Campaign, yes, indeed. We are a partner with the Poor People's Campaign. There was a video that was put together from Jewish organizations through the auspices of the Religious Action Center of the Reform Movement when they kicked off their march back in June. And I was one of the people who spoke in that video. I've had the opportunity to sit on a dais with Reverend Barber. I think they're really doing very important work. They are a profoundly grassroots movement. So they are a little hard to partner with because they don't always clearly communicate what partnership looks like, but when they do, we show up for them. So I hope that answers the question. Resilience in this moment, boy. I want to say, I think it's, it kind of goes back to the stereoscopic vision I was talking. I think I think the last 3.5 years have demanded that we cultivate resilience any way we possibly can. And I'm making a political reference, and I think the environmental crisis that we're facing also, you know, it's just a pause. I've been talking about the psychological definition of resilience, and resilience is also an engineering term. You guys live in San Francisco, you know what I'm talking about. Resilience also talks about building structures that can withstand things like earthquakes or rising floodwaters and the like. And I've done a little bit of exploration to that. I just don't find the metaphors all that helpful. It tends to get quite technical rather, and it doesn't map onto the religious pieces all that well. But I think if we're not going to give up, then we have to be working toward cultivating resilience. And I think that fierce commitment, which I come to from a deeply Jewish place, helps me on those mornings when I wake up in despair and when I think maybe I just want to stay in bed. You know, maybe I can't pull the covers off my head. That mandate that we are here and we are agents. We are humble agents. So I think both the kind of grim yet enlivening commitment to resilience is, I think, really just necessary. And I've been so blown away by so many examples of resilience that I've seen. I mean, I want to say that, and then I want to talk about the next piece of it. Like, you know, just the creativity and the care and the concern that you, when you, you know, that the Fred Rogers quote, look for the helpers. And you see so many instances of generosity and of creativity. And so some of it's on a local level, and some of it's like, you know, in the Jewish ecosystem, you know, I know how you guys pivoted. I know how we at Reconstructing Judaism pivoted on a dime. On March 12th, we learned that Montgomery County, where Reconstructing Judaism is located, was at the epicenter of the virus in Pennsylvania, and we were shut down. And the same time, I was in New York that day, and I heard it. We had an executive committee meeting, and so I sat there and heard that we were being shut down. And in the same exact meeting, I heard that we had digitized versions of our prayer books, and they were already out to all the congregations, so that if you wanted to be streaming services on Friday the 13th, you could. And that at that same meeting, I heard, because I have the extraordinary people who work with me at Reconstructing Judaism, that the first compilation of the virtual Shabbat box, where we curate some of our extraordinary resources from Hashivenu and from Evolve, our groundbreaking conversations website, and from Ritual Well, our amazing website on creative rituals, that was in people's email inboxes on Friday the 13th. So that kind of creativity right away, and we saw it across, you know, I know it happened at Or Shalom, and we saw it at Reconstructionist congregations across the country and in the larger Jewish community. So that kind of resilience. The flip side of it is, I talked about how resilience presumes that there's trauma. Like, so I do feel like we've all been like coping and creating and jerry-rigging, you know, MacGyvering to make it all work. And Katie, you and I have talked about this, there's also going to be trauma on the far side of this. There's also going to be the grief and the losses from the 150,000 dead, to the lasting illnesses from the people who have suffered from COVID, to the lost, you know, the lost high school experiences and college, you know, we could just go on and on. And I'm especially concerned about you know, the first responders who are in the hospitals, you know, pouring their hearts into saving the lives of people with inadequate supplies, with inadequate PPE and ventilators and the like. So I do see profound resilience, and I'm keenly aware that there will come a moment, and that we are grieving in real time, and we are going to need to offer to draw on all of our resources and all of our wisdom to figure out how to mourn. And you know, we know from, this is another incredible teaching from our ancestors, that we mourn and we give it the space that it needs, and then we get up and re-enter our lives powerfully. We are changed. We are even scarred, and we are supported to, and invited to, and even mandated to live, to choose life.
I think that is, I feel like that is a really wonderful place to pause and to just take a breath and take that in. And I think we should just be, at Or Shalom, I'll share with you, Deborah, one of our customs is to express applause like this. So maybe Lillian, you could put us on gallery view, and let's just be appreciative of Rabbi Deborah Waxman, who has been doing such amazing work. It's such a blessing to have you here to share with us, to hear about all of the resources that are available for us, and to remind ourselves of the practices, the people, the podcasts, the songs, the texts, the rituals, all of the things that are a part of our inheritance as Jewish people, as Reconstructionists, as humans, all of these ways that we have tools to meet this moment. And it's you have given us a lot to think about and a lot to explore. And it's a big gift. So I thank you. And I want to say, if there's any other things that you want to say to wrap up, you can. I also feel like it would be wonderful to just move right into a prayer for healing, if that feels right to you. So
can I just say one thing, which is like, yeah. I just want to say that what a blessing it is to return to Or Shalom, and how exciting it is for me as I skim to see that there are folks from up and down the West Coast who have also joined in. So I think we actually have about 7 or 8 Reconstructionist congregations represented here, and that's really thrilling, including, and one from the East Coast, God bless Susan Beckerman, who's sitting in New York and who also was zoomed in. So just I can't tell you how much it fills me up to see all of your faces. So I just wanted to say thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. God willing, we'll have in-person visits to look forward to soon. And in the meantime, this really is filling me and us, and we're so blessed. And Deborah, it is late. So if you would like to bow out, you can, but we'll, for those of us who have the koach, the energy, we will continue with a prayer for healing, a kaddish, and a closing song. Thank you to Daraba. So I'm asking Lillian to open up our chat. And if you have names of anyone that you have in your heart that you're praying for their healing, you can put them in the chat right now. I'm going to also read our healing list from Or Shalom's community. And then we'll join together in a prayer for healing and send our love out that way. So I'm just going to move on to our healing list here. If I see names come up in the chat, then I'll add them as I can. Audrey Rosenheim, Michael Spitko, Benita Palmer, Rosalind Muroff, Tara Trudell, Bat John Velu, Leonard Licata, Susan Levine, Margot Freistadt, Janet Beach, Lisa Nussbaum, Herb Peterson, Michael Reddy, Sunshine Mugrabi, Varghese George, Harry Chesley, Barbara Olisoff Rothbaum, Bruce Minoff, Misha Holm, Shirley Jaslow, Karen Brenner, Dario Ryan Abramskine, Rosalie Weiner, Carolyn Moore Cochless, Judy Bush, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and all of those impacted by COVID-19. Rita Shabby, Catherine Cuff, Helen Boyden, Natan Ben Yitzchak, Vimiriam, Harry Manhoff, Sandra Silva, Neil Segil, Katie Haslam, Mark Davis, Sarah Bat Avraham Verut, Ella, Andy Gordon, Didi Stern, Lee Garcia and Bobby Engel, Howard Wolin, Roseanne Smith, Hannah Bat Avraham Verut, Trudy Lionel, Michael Caravas, Shari Dickstein Staub, Roberta Sachs, Michael Jacobs, Brian Copeland, Beck Garcia, Jody Lerner, Betty Reed Soskin, Delia Prado, Catherine Diamond, Madeline Chappelle, Roseanne Smith, Susan Kahn, Mitchell Rothlin, Elizabeth Richardson, Hannah Bat Avraham Verut, Gabriella Schultz, Beth Bird, Ralph Nieder Westerman, Sharon Richardson, Danny Weiss, Leonard Levine, Jonathan Yitzchaki, Lisa Dayan, Ricky Moskowitz, Henry Glassman, Jan Peters, Addie and Richard Weinstein, Bob Porterfield, Henry Glassman, Sam Geffner, Tom James, and Phyllis Thurm. And I hope I saw all those names in the chat. If I missed one, I apologize. So again, let's just bring those names, those people, imagine them filled with light, surrounded by light. And I invite you also to just do a very brave thing, which is to pray for your own healing right now. Not always easy to ask for things that we need, or to admit the places in which we may ourselves be broken and wounded. So have the courage, pray for your own healing.
And I'll also mention four other names. These are the names of people who are moving through our country's immigration system, either in detention or otherwise. Or Shalom is a sanctuary synagogue, and some of our members are accompanying people as they go through their interactions with ICE and so on. And so we're praying for their healing. Jaime, Belisa, Jose, and Diego are also in our hearts. And I think because I'm betting this is the most widely known healing prayer, I'm going to ask you to join me for the Debbie Friedman's Misha Berach. So sing where you are, and we send our prayers outward. Misha Berach Avotenu Mekor HaBracha Leimotenu. May the source of strength who blessed the ones before us help us find the courage to make our lives a blessing, and let us say Amen. Misha Berach Imotenu Mekor HaBracha Me'avotenu. Bless those in need of healing with refuah shlema, the renewal of body, the renewal of spirit, and let us say Amen. So I want to mention a couple things that are coming up, and then we'll wrap things up with a Kaddish and a closing song. First of all, again, thank you, Rabbi Deborah. It's been thrilling. It's been so wonderful to have all of you here. All of you are welcome to come back to Or Shalom's online offerings whenever you can, and let us know if you want to find out more, and you can connect to us anytime from wherever at this point, because this is where it's happening. Let's see some highlights that are happening. We're doing some really good work with counteracting voter suppression. You'll see that we're working with an organization called Reclaim Our Vote to alert folks who may have been purged from voter rolls that they've been disenfranchised, and those are particularly we're focusing on communities of color and communities that have various kinds of disadvantages. So there's a postcarding effort, there's also a phone banking effort, and there's more to come. So you can look at our website and our newsletter to find out more. We're going to have a postcarding party by Zoom to give everyone a chance to be social while you're doing that. That'll be August 30th, my birthday. And so hope that you can participate in that. We're also in the midst of a series about contemporary Israel, and check that out. We have a teacher who is in our community, Vavi Turan, as well as our tour guide who was guiding us last year on our first congregational trip there. So that's ongoing and upcoming. The month of Elul is so full of offerings that I have a whole blast that's coming out to you very soon about it. We are doing embodied spiritual practice on the 29th. We are going to be initiating a Bay Area-wide daily shofar blast at 10 a.m. If you have a shofar, go outside and blast it at 10 o'clock every morning of Elul, except for Shabbat. What else? So much, I'm sure I'm missing things, but just, you know, tune in. You'll find out about what we're doing, and I hope you can join us for as much as possible. And with that, I think we're going to shift into
taking a time to remember those that we have loved and lost. And we're going to say Kaddish and then close with one more prayer song. So I have here with me a list of those yard sites that fall at this time of year, and also some recent losses. Again, if you have names that you would like to add to the chat, you can, if you're saying Kaddish right now. We remember Phyllis Goldstein, mother of Marianne Goldstein. We remember Bob Hauser, uncle of Seraph White. We remember the following whose yard sites fall in the early part of August. Benjamin Olasoff, Merrill Colvison, Sarah Olech, Errol Bird, Rachel Moore, Erwin Stahler, Bobby Rousseau, Samuel Schlanger, Alice Klein, Norman Hall, and Jack Garfinkel. And I see some names coming up here as well. Peter Quant, Shmuel Peretz, Jonathan Wertschaffers, Yartzeit, Doris Lewis, Shmuel Peretz. And I hope I didn't mangle any of those names too badly. So may those memories of those who we have loved illuminate us, and may the practice of saying Kaddish be one of those many tools of resilience that we turn to in a time of loss, taking strength knowing that our ancestors have shared this experience in their own ways over time, and that they too have spoken the very same words in this path of recovering and turning towards life after having a brush with death of one sort or another. So if you are saying Kaddish, I invite you to rise.
Yigadal v'yikadash shemei rabah, be'alma divrach yirteh v'yamlich malchuteh, b'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chayeh d'chol beit Yisrael, ba'agala uv'izman kari v'yimru amen. Yehei shmei rabah mevorach le'alam ol'almei almaya, yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitpa'ar v'yitromam v'yitnaseh, yitadar v'yitale v'yitalal shemei d'kudsha b'rechu, Le'ela mikol birchata v'shirata, tushbachata v'nechemata, da'amiran be'alma v'imru, amen. Yehei shlama rabba min shemaya v'chayim alenu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru, amen. Ose shalom b'mromav, hu yase shalom alenu v'al kol Yisrael v'al kol yoshvei tedal v'imru, amen.
You may be seated. And oh, I see one more name here, Anoli Dahlstrom. So I thought we would end with Shalom Alechem, which I didn't bring to us earlier, sending us back into Shabbat and remembering the blessings of not just the sort of supernatural angels out there, but the angels that are one another and that we're called to be in this world. So we welcome that angelic energy around us and within us. Please sing along.
Shalom Alechem, Malachei Asharei,
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom, everyone. So great to see you. Be well.
Oh, everyone.
We'll hold this open for just a couple minutes if people want to schmooze, and then we'll say.
Hi, Deborah.
Hi, Susan.
Hi, nice to see you.
It was so great to see you.
Hi, Alan Markham.
Wonderful to have to have guests from beyond our community. It's a big pleasure.
I see
Patty and Mark. Are you still here? Nope.
Hi. We had folks from Dor Chadash in San Diego, from Kedem in Palo Alto, from Malibu, Stephen Weinberg from. From KI, Janet Leahy's on. It's really, but Susan Beckerman, you traveled the furthest.
I saw
both Rachel and Josh and Diane from Orzarua. So.
We got a crowd in Cheyenne.
Yeah, you know, we did this Reconstructionist Shabbaton last year and had a chance to travel around the area and host Rabbi Deborah and sing together and just visit one another. And this is reminding me how wonderful it is to have a wider community and a movement that connects us, and to have kindred spirits that aren't, you know, that really are across the country, even internationally, but the folks who are kind of all searching in together. So it's, I really appreciate it.
Can I tell my favorite story from that visit?
Yeah.
It was so wonderful. It was a kind of like a traveling Shabbaton where I was in all three, I think Susan Levine, I don't think you came to Or Shalom, actually. I think you stayed on that side of the bay. But so it culminated. So Friday night was at Or Shalom, Saturday morning was at Or Zeruah, and Saturday afternoon was at Ner Shalom in Kotati. And
very, I was at all three.
That's so, it was so great. And the Ner Shalom is very, very, very musical, and they have a standing band, and it was really amazing. And Katie and Reb Irwin and I, we all spoke. But in terms of the music, the Ner Shalom musicians were really carrying it, but it was clear that there was someone there, and we knew that it was Josh Wershafter from Or Zeruah, who came, who plays many, many instruments, and came with his fiddle and joined in just so gorgeously to some beautiful setting that the Ner Shalom musical group was performing. And so for me sitting there, I thought it had been planned as part of the Shabbaton and that it had been rehearsed. And it was so gorgeous. And at the end, I remember Reb Irwin looking and saying, "That was so beautiful. Who are you?" And so it was it had to do with Josh's musicianship. And it was such a beautiful thing to say, "Oh, well, I'm here with this group of people who had crossed the bay to come to Or Shalom on Friday night, and then had slept up to Sonoma County for Saturday afternoon." And just everything about it, how it harmonized, just it still fills me with so much joy.
When we're back in person, we will do it again, because all of our communities are so deeply musical. Or Shalom as well, although that night we deferred and did less musical programming, but we.
But I remember Corey had his ukulele. Like you had, there was music still.
We have it. All of the Bay Area recon communities seem to be super musical, and I think we should. When we're able to make music in person together, we will rock.
thanks for the shout out, and I'm honored. But I think that it sticks in the memory because it was symbolic of the harmony between the communities at a spiritual level.
It was so beautiful. It was so beautiful.
Yeah, it was a gift. All right, everybody, it is 8:30 here. It's very late on the East Coast, and I'm gonna say Shabbat Shalom to everyone. Thank you for being here.
Great to be here. Shalom.
Great to see you.
Great to see you, Susan, too.
Thank you. Thank you.
Susan, a real treat to see you. Yeah.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
This is the part I don't like, where you click the button.
Where suddenly you're all alone again. You're just out of the Zoom. Well, we're, you know what? These connections, they go beyond physical space. Mira, yeah. I'm connecting to you even after we turn off this computer.
It's usually, you know, we're always hugging and hugging.
It's true. When the pandemic started, we were like, what are we going to do? Our spiritual practices are eating, hugging, and singing. Now we're Zooming. Zooming is on the list now. Zooming.
Yeah, that was a beautiful service. Thank you.
Good night, everyone.
Excellent.